favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Make the right decision.
Hi everyone, welcome to Special Presentation with Mike and Ethan,
or
Elf Will Not Be Seen Tonight.
You remember way back in the yesteryears of probably, I think, last year when we watched Marmaduke 2010?
Yeah, the halcyon days of yesteryear. I do remember watching Marmaduke 2010.
The folly of youth. We thought no dog movie could ever be worse. Actually, no, that's not true. I'll bet those Space Buddy movies are a lot worse.
Yeah. Well, it turns out that they made another Marmaduke movie, and this one's from 2022.
I couldn't fathom. Someone was like, you know what? We can't just leave this Marmaduke on the shelf. There are more stories to be told about Marmaduke.
Well, that's true, because if you think about like movies about dogs, and I mean dog movies as a genre, right? Because I think we've discussed this concept of dog movies.
Yes.
There are two plots that dog movies have. There's either moving to a new neighborhood and having to fit in, or got to win the big contest. And they did one of those for Marmaduke 2010. So I guess they were like, well, we got to do the other plot for Marmaduke 2020. So they did. The absolute madmen, they did it.
They actually did. And now there are no further Marmaduke stories to be told.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Brad Anderson looked out, Ozymandias looked out and wept because there were no more Marmaduke stories to be told. No, Alexander. Sorry, that's who it was.
Alexander, yeah.
Yeah.
My name is Brad Anderson, king of big dogs.
Ethan, how do you feel about Marmaduke 2020?
Marmaduke 2023 is a film that feels like somebody scooped up a unproduced script for Marmaduke 2010 and just went ahead and made it.
Yeah, it's hard to describe, but everything about this movie feels extremely 2010. Like the style of the animation, the plot, even the music. It's got a lot of that kind of, you know, 2010 kind of punk pop music in it.
Yes.
And
I might even go so far as to say it doesn't even feel like 2010, more like 2003.
Yeah. There's definitely the way a lot of the characters in this move where they don't really walk, they either bounce or float.
Yeah, that was my favorite thing about it, actually, is the way that these ostensibly human characters move like they're in VeggieTales.
Yeah. It looks very cheap and very old.
Yes.
It reminds me of like you said, in 2005 or so, if you were like, you know, when Netflix was really starting to be a big thing and yeah, they were just scooping up like direct to dumpster Chinese and Czech animated films and just throwing them out there. And, you know, so if you wanted to, you could watch like a dozen movies about like, you know, a rabbit that played soccer or something. And
yeah, I remember looking at the first Netflix, Netflix Direct back when the major Netflix business was just mailing you CDs.
Yeah.
I remember looking at their offerings and just being like, man, if you want to watch zero budget documentaries about weed, Netflix has got you covered.
Yep. That was what it was like back then. You know, it was like already they were like they were pioneering their model of like, hey, we have an infinite library of things you will never want to watch. And that's kind of what it is now, isn't it?
Well, now there's an infinite library of things I would want to watch, but as I just have such choice paralysis, I don't watch any of them.
I always think it's funny because now it's like, oh, anything that you could possibly want to watch is like, you got to pay extra for. Like, like literally when we were like, when we were going to do the Annie episode and it's like, well, I got to watch Annie and it's like, pay up. And it's like, come the fuck on for Annie. Like
Annie.
It's like, we are the first people who've probably watched Annie in 20 years. So you cannot convince me that like, you know, that's a high demand film. But anyway, Marmaduke.
Yes.
I have to say though, this movie it's not a good movie. It's kind of pretty bad, but I actually really liked it.
Oh, good.
I don't know how to describe it, but like I was entertained. I was invested. You know, it took a little while for me to warm up to it, but once I did, I was like, okay, I'm kind of down for this Marmaduke adventure, as doofy as it is. I think. You know what? I think, well, I don't know. Like, I think part of it is, you know, I just recently saw the movie Argylle.
Mm.
I don't know if I've mentioned this before.
I don't know if you mentioned it on the show.
Okay. Well, I just recently went to the theater and saw this movie Argylle, which is basically, it's a rom-com kind of spy spoof. And it is, a terrible movie. And 100% convinced that this movie was written by ChatGPT. Like, it was just all done by AI. It's hard to describe exactly why, but if you ever watch this movie, it is just insane in ways that no human would ever create a movie to be insane. And
is that the movie that has the kind of skating scene at the
that's
end?
That's it. Yes.
Okay. Because I did see that part, and I was like, huh, okay.
Like, yeah,
it's no Matrix bullet time, but it's pretty memorable.
Yeah, the skate scene, people really did not like the skate scene, though. Honestly, I didn't think they liked it.
Oh,
well, a lot of people got upset. I thought it was something when I saw it, I was like, okay, this is very silly. But like, the part of the problem was the movie is very tonally inconsistent. So like, if the whole movie was very kind of cartoonish and silly, that would be pretty okay. Even though it was filmed, like someone mentioned that, like it was a MasterCard commercial. but you know, there were that scene itself, I don't think was the main problem with the movie. There were a lot of problems with the movie. I could go on and on about the problems with the movie, but here's the thing. So I was watching Marmaduke, right? And I was thinking, as I was watching it, it's like, this movie is insane and stupid and bad, but all in ways that a human would do it, you know?
Yes! Oh my god, we are in sync! That is exactly what I was thinking the whole time.
Yeah, it's kind of refreshing, you know?
Yeah. It feels like watching a person fall on their face.
Yeah.
You know? It's you know, it felt like I was making a human connection with these people who were like, oh god, gotta get up early and make sure we make this Marmaduke movie. Ugh.
Yeah.
It felt like the creators were suffering along with us. And,
yeah.
You know, I think that's important.
No, I think you're right. Like, I don't think anyone involved in this was like, oh, we need to tell another. We have another Marmaduke story inside us that needs to be told. Like, this was obviously just made as a cash grab because they had the rights to Marmaduke. But
I mean, look at the if you look at the end credits, this movie was almost entirely made in China. And it's like, what cultural cachet does Marmaduke have in China?
They do love big dogs in China. I guess.
Don't
I
they?
Don't know.
Right? I mean, yeah. Like, what kind of Chinese dogs can you think of? Shih Tzu? Okay, bad example.
Well, actually, this movie being made in China kind of adds another layer to I was going to say very typical dog racism that we see later in this film.
Oh yeah.
Because it is a dog movie, and I mean, I think I was kind of expecting it to come to happen, because every dog movie does that. You know how it is. When we say dog racism, right, it's like there's a chihuahua, and you know the chihuahua is going to be like, oh, I'm a chihuahua. I talk all Mexican. I love to eat tacos, like that, you know?
Yes.
And there's a French poodle, so, oh, she's going to be all like, oh, wee, wee. Yeah, okay. You know, it's that sort of thing. Yeah, the fact that it's made in China kind of, because, well, I guess we'll probably get
that's
to that.
That sort of makes me disappointed that they didn't portray Marmaduke as being, you know, excessively Danish. Like Marmaduke always getting up with his paws on his hips and going, I'm Hans Christian Andersen. Andersen, that's me.
Well, as we learn in this thing, he's the not so great Dane.
Yeah, yes. I'm kind of Hans Christian Andersen.
But this movie is it's very strange, but like all the kind of weird leaps of logic that it makes are ones that you're prepared for because you've seen them happen in so many other movies that they're like cliches, and your brain doesn't stop to think that, oh, that doesn't make any sense, you know? And that's because it's made by humans. And
it's made by humans who have seen a lot of movies, but they probably haven't actually seen any dog shows, or
that's true. Yes.
Possibly no dogs.
I don't think that this is an accurate representation of what a dog show is like.
I like how they go directly from the regional neighborhood dog show to like the world championships.
Yeah. Like that's funny. Cause Marmaduke like fails out of the regionals, but then he basically, well, I guess we'll get to some of this stuff. It doesn't make sense, but it's like, yeah, presumably 90% of the people watching this have never been to a dog show, and nobody making this has been to a dog show, so just assume it's whatever you want it to be. It's like a combination.
Seems
between...
like a lot of people watch that Westminster dog show, though, and it seems that's, like somebody should remember something from it.
That's true, but I mean, if it was like a
apart
real
from
dog
the dog
show,
trials,
it,
that's
it'd
the only
get
part
pretty
they
boring if it was a real dog show. So
yeah,
they kind of make this a combination like martial arts tournament, talent show, Miss America pageant type, you know, but
to be honest, if they had made it a straight martial arts tournament, that would have been so much cooler.
That would have been pretty cool. That would have been pretty good.
Especially because, you know, you have all these dogs coming from different countries. So it'd basically be like Street Fighter, but with dogs.
Oh, shit. Actually, that would be really good. Actually, they should have done that. That would have been way better.
So the poodle could have been like doing capoeira, and the British dog would be, I don't know, what's a British, you know, Marquis of Queensbury rules boxing, that kind of thing.
Yeah, they could have. There's a lot that could have been done there. But, you know, they decided they went the easy way. This is all pretty standard stuff. There are a couple of things that are a little unusual in this movie, though. And but let's begin by let's discuss, I think, the thing that most people notice first of all, which is the animation in Marmaduke.
The animation in Marmaduke, basically everyone is either shaped like a rubber band or a gumdrop.
Yes. Nobody has any bones. They're all animated like Turkle in Trouble. It's kind of fascinating to watch. The dad in this, Phil.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Once again, no mustache.
Yeah, that is really like, I don't know what that is probably the biggest sin of this movie. Because,
what is their anti-mustache deal with this guy? It's like, Phil has one personality trait, his mustache.
Yeah.
And you keep leaving it out.
It's really, that was the thing. It's like, I was watching this and I just kept thinking, like, why would you do that? It's like, everybody loves that. Like, everybody knows he's the guy who looks like, you know, Edward Munch's Scream with a mustache. That's Phil. And instead, they kind of make him look like the Wunsler. And, In fact, I would say there's a distinctly Dr. Seuss look to a lot of these characters.
Which is weird because that's sure not how Brad Anderson draws.
No, it's not. I think they were trying to adapt Brad Anderson's very distinctive kind of look into a more typical, you know, rounded Pixar type, you know, world, which yeah. computer animation seems to always go for that look.
To be honest, I feel like they had, like they just had this assortment of characters and there was a Great Dane in there and someone was like, hey, why don't we make a Marmaduke movie? We've already got a Great Dane modeled.
I mean, probably, because like none of them really like have, I mean, none of the other members of the Winslow family in the comic strip, I don't remember anything about them, so I can't say whether or not they're accurately portrayed in this movie. None of them have any personalities in the comic strip. No. So
Phil does not have his mustache, and you know, I don't think the mom has that ass in the comics.
Yeah, the mom's ass in this is off the hook. We have seen a lot of mom asses. You know, in these things, and
I explicitly look for them.
Yeah, and it's like that is like this is okay. The mom's ass in this is just like her thighs are the size of like the dad's whole body, and she looks like, I mean, if you took like Dexter's mom and Courtney Babcock and Mrs. Fantastic all together don't have as much ass as this mom. This is like
one cheek is the equivalent of a whole ass of one of those other women.
Yeah, this is like the Hartman hips are off the charts here.
Yeah,
the mom also like she's got no chin, which really makes her again. She is the most Dr. Seuss looking character in this whole movie, to be honest.
Yeah. You know, in some ways, it feels like what they really wanted was to get Aardman.
Yeah, no, I can see it. I think, like, you know, if you're going to do a Brad Anderson movie, you know, to adapt his comic style into a movie, you kind of have to do like Squiggle Vision, like Dr. Katz, I feel.
Yeah.
You
know?
But
I don't believe they've ever made a Squiggle Vision movie.
No, I don't think so. The only thing we get in the credits, we do get like a little flash cartoon done in the Marmaduke style. Which is fun because there's a Marmaduke rap, which again makes it feel very 2005.
Oh my God. You know, yes, let's close out our movie with the worst rap you have ever heard. Oh my God. This makes Barney Rubble's rap feels like murder was the case.
Yeah, it's like, well, you know, if you were to think, okay, what would, if Marmaduke, the dog, were to rap, what would it be like? It would be like this. It'd be like, my name's Marmaduke, and I'm here to say I'm a really big dog, and I'm gay. No, he doesn't say that. I don't know. I couldn't think of anything that rhymes with say.
Bow. Wow. Everybody say bow. Wow.
Yeah, he does at the end say like Marmaduke, he's a big dog, yo. So that's pretty great. I love that. I just love this the worst rap ever, but it is a great little stinger for this most 2005 movie.
If you just felt an earthquake, don't worry. That was just B.I.G. spinning in his grave.
You know, he's pretty big, but he's not as big as Marmaduke.
No.
Now, the thing about everyone looks like made out of pipe cleaners or like water balloons in this movie.
Yeah, they've got that kind of Fido Dido look.
Yeah. And I mean, it's again, it makes it look very 2005, but it's, I don't know. I mean, it kind of grew on me after a while, just because it's so exaggerated that it feels like they have a little more character than most animated films nowadays.
Yeah. To their credit, there are a lot of different people shapes in this.
Yeah.
However, to their discredit, not enough, because you do see when they reuse them in crowd scenes.
Yeah, yeah.
There's this one specific scene. Okay, the kids have this one huge fat gumdrop shaped friend. This kid looks like the teenage version of Grimace. And there's a scene where he says, oh, wow, we get to meet Marmaduke. Let's get in line. So he and his stubby little friend get in line, and you can see behind them that two people that look exactly like him, a big fat guy and a little stubby guy with the exact same character model, are already in line. It's like, oh man, we're ahead of ourselves.
Yeah, there's this does seem like a very, like I said, a very cheap movie. There are some interesting background characters, because we do have like, there's like an elderly Sikh background character that we see in a few scenes, which is an interesting little,
I did notice him. Yeah, that was a surprising touch.
Yeah, yeah.
I also like the design of the clown.
Yeah, yeah. The clown, I think, who also appears in the rap at the end as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's not like without its charm. I feel like, and plus like Marmaduke, I feel like Marmaduke's character design is, interesting, because I won't say he's appealing, but I kind of like that they really leaned into like, look, this is a big gangly dog, and
Gangly, really ugly dog.
Yeah, yeah. And they really made him like almost Rango levels of ugly. So I kind of respect that.
I mean, there is a certain, you know, there's a lot of appeal to this movie, but it's scattered.
Yes.
To the point where you can really tell who making what scene was trying and who wasn't.
Yeah, yeah. It is a strange movie. I felt like the basic plot is, okay, so Marmaduke, causes mischief, and, that causes, he falls into a pool, I think is what happens.
Yeah. And he falls into a pool, and I guess he bursts a water main, because the entire neighborhood is flooded when he falls into the pool.
Oh yeah, that's right. Cause we were trying to figure out, like, is that just like the splash from the pool, because that seems like an awful lot of water, you know?
Yeah, their kitchen. There was 3 feet of water in their kitchen. It's like, you would not get that from a single inflatable above-ground pool. So, you know, I appreciate the use of, you know, cartoonish exaggeration here, but, you know, it's one of those things that works a lot better. You know, it works a lot better with better timing.
Yeah, yeah. There's, you know, again, this is not like high art, this film. It could have been vastly improved, in a lot of places. But this thing happens with the pool, and, it goes viral, and some woman on TV is like, wow, that dog, what a goober. Not even
that viral dog is, yeah, one viral dog.
That's one viral dog. But like, it's like, not even Guy Hamilton, the greatest dog trainer in the world, could train this dog. In fact, I call you out, Guy Hamilton. If you can't train this dog, you're a piece of shit. And Guy Hamilton happens to be watching, and he's like, I'll train that dog. And that sets the plot in motion. Oh, sorry. I've just been
Guy
informed.
Hamilton is an interesting character. I mean, you wouldn't guess it from his name, but he's Asian.
Is he?
I'm pretty sure he was supposed to be, yeah.
Oh, I did not notice that at all. I'm going to ask, what's the evidence besides?
I think it's his emphasis on kind of Eastern techniques. You see him teach Marmaduke a martial art, and also you see him getting super hot for the Chinese judge.
That is true. We also do see a couple other characters later in the movie who we can assume are Asian from their style of dress and or the fact that they are accompanying the Asian dog entry in the contest, but they just look like white people. Like, they're animated to look like white people. So, you know, I guess like, it's like, look, we used up all our diversity on that one Sikh guy. So, We're not going to put any Asians in this movie. Guy Hilton, I've just been informed, his name is not Hamilton. he is an interesting character, because he is not the sort of character I would expect if I were making a movie about a dog trainer, you know?
Right.
He's kind of, they kind of have him as kind of an Elton John Eurotrash sort of guy. And I would have thought like, oh, Dog Trainer, you're good. They're going to have like a drill sergeant type character in that role. But no. The movie does kind of bounce around a bit before it figures out what it wants to do. Cause
yeah,
the first half is like Guy Hilton shows up and is trying to train Marmaduke, and Marmaduke is resisting. And then Marmaduke halfway through, just, I guess he kind of decides to, no, I do want to be a show dog. And then it's about going to shows. And it's funny because the first half of the movie, it's literally just Marmaduke and people. So
yeah,
I was thinking the Marmaduke should be a mute character because he's got no one to talk to. And these Marmaduke witticisms aren't really that good. So, you know, it just seemed like he should be mute like in the comic strip. But then halfway through the movie, we meet all these other dogs and it's like, oh, OK, now there's reason for him to talk. So I guess that's fine, too.
He should have had other pets to talk to, because you know there's just the cat. Oh, just like the other Marmaduke movie, this one Marmaduke's best friend is a Seal Point cat with a different ethnic coding than you would expect.
Yeah, what is the cat in this one? In Marmaduke 2010, the cat was coded Latino, but this one I couldn't quite tell what the cat was supposed to be.
No, it's. You know, it's a vaguely Siamese looking cat, but the cat doesn't come across as Asian either. So, you know, the cat just kind of comes across as, you know, a white guy like the rest of the family.
Yeah, the cat is very like kind of got that kind of posh accent, I think.
Yes.
So it's like, it's an upper crust cat. This cat, though, like this cat, again, very weird character design on him because he is, again, very Dr. Seuss-y.
Yes.
For a while, we couldn't figure out what was wrong with this cat, why this cat was giving us uncanny vibes, but it's a combination of things. One of them being that the cat does not have slit pupils. It's got like round human.
Yeah.
Pupils.
You noticed that too?
Yeah. I didn't think it would bother me as much as it did, but it really did.
It does look very weird on a cat. Yeah.
Yeah.
Unless they're as stylized as Garfield.
Yeah, that's true. The other thing, though, is this cat does not have a cleft lip, which.
Oh, you're right. Oh, yeah. Which that.
It's very strange because when they have the close ups of the cat's face again, it looks like a Dr. Seuss character. He's Marmaduke's.
You're right. The cat in the hat doesn't have a cleft lip either.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So the cat is kind of like Marmaduke's frenemy, you know.
Actually, I think they're tighter than the other two.
They are. There's they seem to be they seem to be enemies at first, but of course later on, during Marmaduke's Long Dark Night of the Soul, the cat comes to his rescue. And that's actually one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie. I think that was actually a really well done scene.
Yeah, I mean if there's a good scene in this one, and I mean that one follows a really kind of long and painful repetitive scene, so you're really glad to see them do something good afterward.
Yeah. It follows,
you know, like the movie, it follows.
There's a lot that happens in Marmaduke.
Yes.
But anyway, here's the important thing. Marmaduke is trained by Guy Hilton, who trains him to be a great show dog using, you know, Eastern Zen techniques and Kung Fu and all this stuff. Marmaduke doesn't like it, but then he does. And
yeah, he leans into it. It's like the Heathcliff episode where he was like, if you can't beat him, join him, and gets really good at obedience school.
Yeah. And then there's like this thing where where Marmaduke is so busy training, he doesn't have time for the family. But then that they don't really go into that. They bring that in and then they immediately forget because it's time for the actual dog show. And now we're like dog showing it up. And that's when we meet the real villain of the movie. who is he, an Afghan? What is this dog?
Yeah, he's an Afghan. Zeus.
Zeus. So Zeus the Afghan, who, I guess that's what Afghans look like, but there's something about his face where he just looks like a Dimetrodon to me. He's got this very, very, the muzzle is more of a snout almost. And he's kind of got these reptilian peg teeth. But he is an interesting character because, like, he's voiced by J.K. Simmons, of all people.
Yeah, that was quite a get, actually.
Yeah.
We haven't talked much about the voices because they don't come up all that much. But Marmaduke is Pete Davidson, or wait, is that his name?
Is he is he a celebrity? Because I know they touted him a bit. So,
Yeah, he's been on Saturday Night Live, and most people don't watch Saturday Night Live, so you might not know. But I just saw him and quite enjoyed him as Mirage, the lead Autobot character in Transformers: Rise of the Beasts.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
It's a character not unlike Marmaduke, and I like how they cast Pete Davidson by looking at the original. Mirage character's character, his bio note from back in 1984 said that he was a rich kid who wasn't sure whether joining the Autobots was actually going to benefit him or not, but he was just going along with his friends. So they were like, so we got to find somebody who comes across as, like, you know, your cool rich friend who has all the toys. So and they got Pete Davidson.
I could see that. He seems to have range.
Yeah. And the other starring role is David Koechner.
And I think he's Phil. Is he Phil?
Yeah. He's Phil. He was also on Saturday Night Live and in part of Second City.
And okay. I
don't know much else about him except that he was in Anchorman.
Oh.
I've never seen Anchorman.
Yeah, I don't recall who he was in that. I have seen it, but it's been a while. This movie, again, probably another reason it feels very 2005 is it is not stuffed with celebrity voices.
No.
They have a few, but then everyone else, I think, are actually just voice actors.
Which... Yeah, actual voice actors. I saw Fred Tatasciore. I saw, I forget her name, the voice of Mika from Transformers Prime. A lot of Transformers connections in this.
Interesting. Well, there is some transformation that happens in this film.
It certainly is. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's right. Now I remember. The cat's name is King Tut. So that's the weird ethnic misconnection.
Oh, does the cat have a name in the comic strip? I feel like he doesn't.
I couldn't tell you if they had a cat in the comic strip.
I think they actually do have a cat, and I think it actually is a Siamese cat. But
okay,
let me look this up because I don't want to give any misinformation about Marmaduke. Yes, according to Wikipedia, which as we know is always right, they do have a cat, a Siamese, which is named King Tut.
Oh, okay. I don't think that was the cat's name in the 2010 movie, was it?
I don't think so. I don't think they named the cat King Tut I feel like in the 2010 movie let me look that one up too. No, they named the cat Carlos.
After Carlos Mencia.
Yeah, well, you know, they did have George Lopez playing Carlos.
Yeah,
so doing. And I mean, no shade on George Carlos. I don't have any beef with him, but like that's the sort of thing that he does when you say, oh, we need a Mexican voice. We need a voice that sounds Mexican. Get George Lopez. Sure.
Yep.
Yeah, but you know, I guess he's good at it. Anyway, you still there?
Yeah, sorry. Dropped my phone. Lost the connection for a second.
Oh, nope. No worries. I was just like, I just killed this conversation with my anti-George Lopez racism.
Nope. Just a little peek into the Headless Lounge, folks.
Well, so King Tut in this is, he's kind of ethnically ambiguous. He does have a voice that makes me think of like the snooty British archaeologist from The Mummy. So maybe that is the King Tut connection. OK, so Marmaduke is now he's in the dog show, the local regional dog show, and we meet Zeus, who is an Afghan who has very shiny fur, because like when his fur shimmers such that he like can hypnotize people with it, which is
he's basically a dog disco ball, and his owners are basically Hans and Franz, but a cross between Hans and Franz and Nelson, because they all have super gorgeous long hair.
Yeah.
So it's like the Fabio twins.
Yeah, that's pretty much, that's it. I think like, I feel like Zeus is kind of, he's a little unusual for this role, because, you know, usually you would expect in this role someone who is a bit, not a J.K. Simmons voice, for sure.
No.
I would have expected a more of a, kind of a, you know, like a posh kind of, you know, Locust Valley Lockjaw voice, kind of like this.
Yes.
You know.
The Harvard voice.
You know, to really play up the snobs versus slobs aspect of this. But yes.
But his owners have German accents, though.
Yeah, that's true. And J.K. Simmons, you know, kind of has this, I don't know how to describe his voice in this. It's J.K. Simmons, you know.
J.K. Simmons doesn't really do a voice most of the time. He's just like, hey, I know what you came for. You came for me.
Yeah, yeah. It's just an unusual vibe for this character, you know, that I can't quite describe. But I mean, I think it works, because it's Zeus is kind of mesmerizing, because you keep trying to figure out like what's going on with him. You know, because
to be honest, I feel that the Marmaduke comic strip would benefit if Zeus were part of it.
Yeah.
I like the idea of giving Marmaduke a rival.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Zeus is the most, he's the most proactive character in the movie.
Yes.
So of course, like we said, all dog movies there's one of two plots. This is the dog show movie. So we all know what's really going to happen. And that is that, the bad dog Zeus is going to sabotage Marmaduke, because he's threatened by Marmaduke's raw charisma. And, he sabotages Marmaduke in the sexiest way possible for this awful gangly dog. Which is,
with a dog like Marmaduke, that's going to take a lot of sexiest way possible.
Yes. But basically, apparently they have a buffet at the dog show. And Zeus tricks Marmaduke into like eating it all, because he's like, Marmaduke, you should eat all this food before the big show. And Marmaduke, you know, is a sucker, so he does it. And then Marmaduke gets real fat, and it's like, whoa, this is really interesting. Marmaduke is fat now. They really animated the hell out of fat Marmaduke. I'll say this: if I was watching this movie when I was like a wee lad of kindergarten age or something,
yes,
I'd be like, ah, yes, here's the fetish that I'm going to like obsess over the rest of my life. But as an adult,
you already had it.
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm saying is, like, as an adult, I'm just like, this doesn't really do much for me now. No. I'm not really into these cartoon dogs anymore. But as a kid, it would have been very interesting.
Now let's. I love how this the championship banquet. It literally is the sumptuous Italian feast. In that, I mean, there's a giant plate of just like hot dogs and buns.
Yeah.
And there's one of sub sandwiches, and there's one of like McDonald's French fries in little cardboard boxes.
it's like when Trump had the McDonald's feast.
Yeah. Oh, and there's a big plate of macaroons. I was like, okay, I can get behind that. But they're so shiny. It's like they've got syrup poured on them. It's revolting.
Yeah, the animators are like, what does food look like? I don't know.
We don't know.
Nobody knows. It's fine. Marmaduke eats all the food, and then he has to go on the show. But luckily, he farts and deflates, and he's fine.
Yeah, and you know, not only that, he farts, deflates, propels himself into the championship cup, and fills it.
Yes. Well, actually, I think we should. This is a little confusing. Okay. I guess, Ethan, my question to you is, did Marmaduke shit in this scene?
I think he's supposed to have shit in the scene. Okay. Yes.
Yeah. Cause my wife is also yelling from the next room that yes, she believes Marmaduke took a huge dump. And, because yeah, what happens is Marmaduke, he farts and deflates and he goes into the championship show, but halfway through he reinflates, and which is, I think, indicating that he needs to go because he's like, oh, I need to go, but he can't reach the fire hydrant. So instead,
yeah,
he sits in the championship cup is there. So he jumps into it. And then there's this tremendous fart and this green gas fills the stadium.
You know? Yeah. It's just like the whiz poppers in Spielberg's The BFG.
Yeah. Yeah. Just like this massive, just like cloud just rolling over everything. It goes on for like Marmaduke's fart does go on for like a solid minute of screen time, because I kind of liked it, not like in a sexual way. I just mean that like it was great because you see him farting and the whole like dog show is filled with like this mutagen colored gas, And then
to save themselves on their animation budget, and I think this is actually very clever, instead of animating everything that happens, the camera pans over a frozen version of everything, and you get to see everyone's reactions as they're, you know, covering their noses and eyes, and, you know, one person is, I think it's that Phil who's barfing into his hat.
Yeah.
One kid isn't even paying attention because he happened to be wearing a gas mask anyway.
Yeah, there's the
clown. And then we zoom out to see birds falling dead in heaps.
Yeah. There's the clown.
And one even falls into the used can trophy cup.
Oh, right, right. Oh, man. There's also, then we also get to see this one girl who's filming it with her cell phone, who's in yelling, "This is awesome!" right before she is like drowned in the gas. And I think that's my favorite thing in the whole movie, is just this one girl who's super excited about getting farted on.
It's not so much fun when it happens to you, is it?
Yeah, apparently it is for her. But then after that whole scene, then we cut to like the parking lot out front and we just see the gas cloud like rolling over the parking lot as people are running for their cars and trying to escape.
And we see this one fat kid get hit by two cars in succession.
Yeah. That was
pretty good.
I have to say that, like, you know, if you're going to do a fart joke, this has got this. They went all the way. Like, they went for the gusto. So I got to respect that. I don't think I've ever seen a fart joke done like to this extent before.
My problem with this movie is that, you know, there are good jokes, there are funny jokes, but they all don't seem scripted. They all seem like they were improvised by the animators and or the voice actors.
The scripted jokes are ones that are like, oh, what if a dog was Mexican, you know?
Yeah.
And those aren't the good ones in this.
No.
But yeah, it's a weird movie. Especially
I do kind of like that because Marmaduke shit in the trophy, that means that nobody gets it. And it's put in a biohazard bin.
Yeah, it was pretty great. And they just leave it in the the trash can there. But unfortunately, Marmaduke's...
Congratulations, Zeus, you played yourself.
Yeah. Unfortunately, well, luckily Zeus still goes to the finals for some reason.
So does Marmaduke.
That's true. For some reason. But Marmaduke gets there by cheating, as we'll see. Because basically what happens is Marmaduke is now persona non grata. Guy Hamilton is like, fuck you, Marmaduke. You're a failure. Get out of my face. Guy Hilton. He's done with Marmaduke. And everyone at school is now making fun of the Winslow kids because they have a dog that farted. You know?
Oh my God. How dare you?
Yeah. It is very funny how how everyone in school is like, don't even look at them. Those awful children with their farting dog.
Yeah. I especially love how the cheerleaders say she shares a home with Scooby Poo. They don't say he's her dog. She says she shares a home with him. Can you imagine? I'd die.
Well, I mean, it is Marmaduke. It's like nobody owns Marmaduke. You just, you know, with Marmaduke, it's either lead, follow, or get out of the way. But yeah, so Marmaduke is now in a bad place. He's in, you know, it's the long dark night of the soul for Marmaduke.
Yes.
And this is a scene where like Marmaduke. Okay, so I really like this bit where Marmaduke runs away from home.
Yeah.
Because
the false defeat.
Yeah. It's like there's this. So Marmaduke, he runs away and we have this scene where he's like running through the city and it's raining, like a pouring. And we have like the ghostly voices of all the people who Marmaduke has failed, like speaking on to him. And there's this kind of pounding synthwave soundtrack. And it's like, wow, this actually goes really hard. You know, this was really the scene where I realized, like, I'm really into this movie. You know, this movie actually pretty won me over. This is also where when Marmaduke is like, he's never going home, but then he sees King Tut like sitting in the middle of the street, and he rescues King Tut like from being hit by a car. And oh God, what does he say? There's some good dialogue here, but I've completely forgotten it.
Yeah, so he says something like, I know there's a good dog in you because he just rescued me.
Yeah. Because I think he's saying it's about like how Marmaduke, you know, his strength is that he'll do anything for his family, you know?
Yeah. As we have said on this podcast before, kids animated movies have two morals. It's either believe in yourself or don't judge a book by its cover. Yes. This is the believe in yourself one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I guess it's also don't judge a book by its cover.
Yeah.
They tend to be.
That's pretty much it. I mean, unless you're doing a Halloween story, then it's also like, you know, you're not too small to do a thing.
Yeah. Don't judge a book by its cover.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. You're right. It's basically the same. There really are only two plots. You're right. So
they're kind of two halves of the same coin.
Yeah. But anyway, so Marmaduke has now decided that he's going to make a state comeback, and he needs to convince Guy Hilton to like train him again. And
yes, also, oh, we left out one of the best references is that they're like, well, all's well that ends well, I guess. We could just go back to having a regular dog. And then they open the mail and they got Guy Hilton's invoice for services rendered.
Oh, that's right. They kind of have that Star Wars crawl, don't they?
Yeah, the invoice is so long that it turns into the Star Wars crawl. And I've got it frozen right here, and it's stuff like training, transportation, cleaning, consulting, manicure, telephone, $9,000. What, you ran up a bunch of bills? And also, Robotech rental.
Oh, does it really say that?
Yeah, it does.
Okay, that's pretty funny.
It's mostly just the same list repeated over and over again, but it is a pretty good quick joke there, but
yeah. Yeah, which is funny because then like the big ass mom is all like, he's gonna charge us, and Phil is like, it was supposed to come out of the prize money, and it's like, Phil, you're dumb, Because seriously, it's like you knew from the beginning Marmaduke is a long shot, and you agreed to like this thing under the assumption you would win $1 million in prize money, which would then all go to training Marmaduke. What an idiot!
Now I'm looking. Now I'm looking at the version that he's holding, and it's got different stuff listed on it. And among other things, there's a charge for pizza machine and pizza with toppings. And oh, the ring of power.
Oh, okay, that's kind of funny. Marmaduke. Now I want
Shark Tank. Water for shark water.
Oh man. I'm trying to find this. I was looking for the scene where Marmaduke. Well, I can't find it now. I was trying to see the clip where Marmaduke runs away from home is on the internet, but never mind. So yeah, they have this huge bill. So now the family is like doubly screwed. Marmaduke really needs to do something to save the day. So he goes to try and get Guy Hilton to take him back. And Guy Hilton is like, no. So Marmaduke just runs around the world.
Is this a Forrest Gump reference?
Oh, yeah, I think it might be, actually. I had not thought about that. But it's, yeah, because Marmaduke literally, he just runs around the entire world and like gets a lot of publicity. Everyone's like, look at this dog running around the world. And then he returns to Guy.
Who took all this footage?
Yeah, you know, it's like Marmaduke on the Great Wall of China, Marmaduke in the Himalayas, Marmaduke scuba diving under the ocean. And
yes, with a shark right behind him.
Yeah, and then he gets back to Guy Hilton. Guy Hilton is just like, no. And he's like, oh, well, I guess that was kind of pointless then. I think then, because like one of the kids comes and delivers a speech about how like Guy Hilton is a loser for not actually being successfully training Marmaduke, which,
yeah,
you know, is true, because that was his whole reason for doing that. It was to prove he wasn't a loser to that one woman on television, and he failed.
Yeah,
at it, so
yeah, he forgot the lesson of that Simpsons episode where, like, you'll be a hero. Who will you be a hero to? Those guys at the feed store.
Yeah. So that gets him to come back and once again train Marmaduke in the twin arts of dogging and showing, I guess. I don't know what. But they're going to go to they're going to go to the big time. They're going to go to the main show, the world championships.
Yeah. Yeah, they're going directly to the world championships after never having won a show before.
Yeah. But luckily, Guy Hilton, they explain this because Guy Hilton just calls up a judge and is like, hey, can you get us into the show? And she's like, yeah. And it's like, oh,
because she's sweet on him and he's sweet on her. So.
Yeah, it's kind of weird because it's like, you know, you could have just not mentioned that and had it been a mystery how he got in, because kids don't care. But instead, you're like, no, we need to explain that Guy Hilton cheated. We need to have that in there, you know. this is where we finally meet all the other dogs other than Zeus. Yeah,
the movie would probably have been better if we gotten to meet some of the other dogs earlier.
Yeah. Now we've got, you know, there's a poodle, you can guess, French.
Yes.
You know, there's a,
kind of French, but mostly like from Girl Land.
Yeah. I mean, you know how these movies are.
Yes.
She's a
poodle is a kind of female, not a kind of dog.
Yes. We also have there's an English bulldog. You can guess, you know, exactly what he's like. He's like, oh, he's me bulldog, oh, you know, like that sort of thing. There is a dog which is named Juan Pedro, and Wikipedia identifies him as a Welsh corgi. That is bullshit. That is clearly not a Welsh corgi. It is a Chihuahua. Come on.
Yeah, it is like an applehead Chihuahua. I mean, I can see him as a corgi mix, but he does not look like a corgi to me. Sorry. No.
I mean, it's obviously a Chihuahua because it's a Mexican dog. His owner is got like Mexican wears like stretch pants with the Mexican flag colors. So
yeah, and there's a big group of people in sombreros waiting to greet her at the red carpet. Come on.
Yeah. So I mean, if this isn't Mexico coded enough for you, I don't know what to tell you, because it's obviously Chihuahua. We also have
actually now I'm doubting it. Now I'm starting to wonder if maybe he actually is a corgi. Well, he looks like a corgi. He's shaped like one.
Well, I mean, I don't think any of the dogs look much like what they're supposed to look like, but I think that
I think what they probably did was they modeled a corgi and then they decided to make him a Chihuahua anyway, without changing the model.
Yeah. Yeah. There is this Asian dog. Now, according to Wikipedia, this dog is Japanese, but when the dog first appears and they flash his name on the screen, there's a Chinese flag. So I'm going to say that Wikipedia is full of shit. This is a Chinese dog.
I mean, this movie was made in China. They don't like giving Japan all the credit.
Yeah. And this is a dog. Look, I mean, this is, how would you really describe this dog? This is,
he's kind of a bro to Marmaduke, honestly.
Yeah. He helps Marmaduke out for reasons that don't really make any sense, I guess.
Yes. You know, it's really kind of being like, ah, the mysterious East.
Yes.
He has his own reasons.
Yeah. He's, he's basically Uncle Iroh from Avatar, I think.
That's a good way of looking at it.
Yeah, he's got mystical powers because he's from, you know, the mysterious East.
He basically has Jedi powers.
Yeah, I think in fact there's a scene when he does his bit in the talent show, and he and his owner are like doing kind of crouching dragon, hidden tiger type stuff. The announcer like literally says, here they are from the mysterious East, a show from the mysterious East, you know, which is, 2022 is a different time, I guess.
Yep.
it's
like, you know, we're just coming out of the pandemic. We don't know if, China is our enemy or not. Things still might go the wrong way. Let's just be on the safe side and portray them as bad guys.
Yeah. Though I guess in the end, he helps Marmaduke out by giving him some Zen koans and that help Marmaduke to triumph over adversity. Though he's kind of, he's kind of a weird character because you would kind of think that Guy Hilton already kind of fulfills this character need of a sensei.
I guess he needed one that can talk to him on a dog level.
And I guess because there's also because Marmaduke also fucks up and kills Guy, not kills him, incapacitates
pretty close
Guy,
though
Guy Hilton.
Yeah.
I can't remember. I guess what's his name? Zeus is cheating,
and he
puts like shampoo that makes Marmaduke slip in the obstacle course and fall on top of Guy, and so Guy's out of the picture. Excuse me. Now Marmaduke has been disqualified because he has no trainer. But
yes, not because he failed at the competition. He actually did great, but after they stopped judging him, then Guy Hamilton, now you got me doing it. Guy Hilton was, injured. No, Alexander Hamilton. My name is Alexander Hamilton.
Yeah. I don't know why that disqualifies Marmaduke, but you know, it's funny cause the family is like, wait a minute, we could just be his trainers, Team Winslow. And it's like, oh, okay. I guess we're getting a last real, theme of family togetherness. Why not?
In Save the Cat they call that the rallying the troops.
I mean, that's a good way to put it. It's one of those things that I feel like if they had really like pushed the idea that like Marmaduke in his training was not able to connect with the family. He was like ignoring the family, and now he realizes the importance of family. This probably would have hit better, but you know, it's a kid's movie. So I'm not really expecting them to really like, you know, be like, okay, we need to harp on the theme. We need to make sure that it's clear. Cause you know, but the family,
if you bore kids for a second, they're going to focus on picking up the carpet instead of your movie. So.
Yes. I will say that like of all the, of the things we've watched lately, this is probably one of the least boring.
No, that's true. I mean, there was no point where I was like, I don't want to watch this because it's not fun. I was mostly just, I don't want to watch this because it isn't good to watch.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, at least it's not like Jane where it's like, just long sequences, people just wandering through the outback and then like stock footage of elephants. At least things were happening in this movie. So I'm trying to think like, so Marmaduke, they have a contest where they have to resist eating, food, and, the Juan Pedro fails, but Marmaduke succeeds because the Chinese dog told him like, you have to, you know, be the pizza.
They're like, we're going to offer each of these dogs a baconized version of their favorite dish. And Juan Pedro fails at not eating the bacon taco. But Marmaduke imagines his own face on the pizza and is like, oh, I don't want to eat that. I'm ugly.
I was a little disappointed that like we didn't get all the dogs. So we didn't have like the French poodle trying to resist like baconized snails or, you know.
Her name is Chanterelle, so I was kind of thinking, what's her favorite food? Mushrooms?
Oh, that's right. Yeah. And then we got like, you know, there's an English bulldog, so I don't know. He'd be like, oh, bangers and mash, bacon. Well, actually, that's a normal food, so that's not really that funny.
You normally have bangers and mash with bacon, right?
I mean, you do, yeah. Well,
I've never had bangers and mash, but...
It's basically sausage and mashed potatoes, isn't it?
That's pretty much it. And if it's, let's see what else. Toad in the Hole. That's just sausage in dough.
Yeah.
And like, you know, probably most of the stuff is just sausage. And it's like full English breakfast. Wait, that actually has bacon anyway.
Yeah. Like honestly, all these things seem like pretty normal. Well, I'm trying to wait. Well, you know, I guess you are eating, there's some disgusting thing.
Baconized iron brew.
There you go. There you go.
I like the use of the phrase baconizing.
fully and permanently baconized.
and loving it.
But Marmaduke. Oh,
let's talk about the judges. We have Judge Molly Smith, a very hippie black woman, Judge Buddy Boy, a big fat white guy, the judge that helped Marmaduke get in the first place. Her name is Amy Chan, a skinny white guy named Max Noodleman, and a grumpy looking Russian woman whose name is Sputnik.
Yes.
Pippa Sputnik.
So she gives a lot of bad, the other judges are easily impressed, but she gives a lot of low scores, which is obviously like a little, you know, joke about the Soviet judges in the Olympics back in the day.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. They always voted any capitalist country down.
Well, you know, and at the time we were like, oh, those Ruskies, but now it's like, yeah, good for them. So it's a little joke for like the adults in the audience, but it does come into play later. There is a reason why Sputnik is so harsh on so many of the dogs. That is because there is cheating going on. There's cheating afoot.
Yes.
It turns out, cause like, I think, does Marmaduke, what was Marmaduke's, talent? In the talent show.
Oh, his special talent, as it turns out, is something that we've seen him do with the kids before, which is playing a horse when they play cowboys.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, he's a big dog. That's the sort of thing that he would be good at. Zeus's talent is just, hypnotizing everyone with his shimmering hair.
And making everyone give him a 10 out of 10.
Yes, which is a good talent to have if you're in a dog
show.
But so all that happens, and then let's see.
Chanterelle gives this sort of Lady Gaga-esque kind of dance performance, which one of the which the announcer describes as being a seductive performance.
Well,
I mean,
she's a lady dog.
This announcer who looks vaguely like Lyman.
Well, explains a lot. That's why Lyman had to go into hiding. And then I think Vinny like does this thing where he lifts the entire stadium.
Yeah, that's actually really cool. They just put a bar on the floor and he lifts it and just everything under his feet kind of burrows into the earth as the entire rest of the building lifts about a foot.
Yeah.
You know, I would have given it to him, honestly.
That is impressive. It's funny because I kind of wish that they had just gone even sillier with that, because what they do is like, they just put a handle on the ground and he grabs a handle and pulls on it. And, you know, the ground right under his feet kind of cracks and everything else lifts up, but he is not. Now, obviously, in real life, you can't lift a thing that you're standing on.
Yeah,
it doesn't work that way, but it would be very funny if they just showed him grab the handle and then immediately cut to outside and just see the whole stadium lifting up, you know, so they never explain. it just seems even more insane that that happened.
What if they did the thing where that makes the hole under him and then his trainer comes up and gently sort of cups the dog and lifts him up too.
Yeah. So it's actually that would be pretty good. This movie, it's got moments. But anyway.
I was kind of down on it when I finished watching it, but talking about it, I realized, this is kind of an improvement on the other one.
The thing is, it's not a good movie. I'd say it's actually, by any objective measure, very, very bad. But, but I'm like, hey, I'm entertained. You know, it kept me watching. And there was more here than the other Marmaduke movie, which is literally just like, it's like every other dog movie you've ever seen in your entire life. This one, at least
the fact that it's animated is probably what's bumping it up.
Yeah. I mean, I think the really weird decisions in character design really go a long way to just like, you know, keeping you watching this thing because it's so strange just where they're like, oh yeah. Yeah. Everyone looks like a hangnail.
One thing. While we're talking about strange design decisions, I want to talk about this movie has a lot more 2D art than I see in almost any other.
Really? Like I know we have the credits has some 2D art. Is there more than that?
The credits have 2D art, but, during the dog show, you have these caricatures of the dogs that you keep seeing that are like hand-drawn versions of them that are clearly not just cell-shaded versions of the models themselves.
Oh. In fact,
and the family photos are all hand-drawn too. And the scene where Marmaduke is running around the world, you get that in a sort of hand-drawn style. So,
oh, you're right.
You know, they did a lot of kind of flash animation tricks in here too. Some of which kind of feel like they were saving a little money on them. Like when they animated when they have shampoo and stuff dripping off people and it's actually hand animated rather than rendered.
No, you're right. It's it makes it feel like this is a movie made by humans.
Yeah. In some ways, it kind of feels like a movie that would be made for YouTube, like by a bunch of, scrappy young animators, but not like that one that actually was made for YouTube with the beatboxing puppy.
The what?
Oh, I'm going to have to tell you about that one after this.
Yeah, that sounds interesting.
It's like they call it the animated Birdemic.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
Oh, speaking of the beatboxing puppy, that is what Shi the Chinese dog does, is they do this Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon thing, and he raps!
Oh, yeah. Yeah, again, 2005.
Yep.
It's, it's, yeah, because they're doing the thing, and then the rap starts, and the dog's wearing, like, shutter shades, and it really is, it's, like, the most 2005 thing ever. Because, like, boy, did they love bad raps in 2005.
Oh, yeah. Even more than they loved them in 1985.
Yeah. You know, I mean, it was just, I guess, because in 1985, it was still kind of like, oh, that's a little spicy. You know, that's all those, that's something those black people like. Oh, I don't know about that.
Yeah.
But by 2005, rap had been completely, completely neutered of all like its protest and, urban edges. So it was just like, oh, it's a thing that like white people can enjoy now. So 2005 white rap.
That's when I got my all my rap albums.
I like when Marmaduke is like, he's a big dog. But anyway, the judges declare that Zeus is the winner, but turns out that there's a reason why we've only seen one of the Fabio twins the whole time they've been at the dog show. And that's because Sputnik is the other Fabio twin in disguise.
Yeah. They pulled a hey, one of the twins doesn't have his teeth stained blue trick.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I remember that Encyclopedia Brown episode.
Yep.
Now this is probably like the, well, I figured out like literally like half a second before Marmaduke did. So, yeah. So I felt very proud of myself. But, I'm sure every child also figured out at the exact same time, if not sooner than me.
Yep.
But then Marmaduke, in order to stop it, the Chinese dog does some like ESP stuff.
He causes one of the bottles of shampoo to roll toward Marmaduke so Marmaduke can wing it at Sputnik and knock off the disguise.
Yeah. And it works. And then so Zeus is disqualified and Marmaduke Marmaduke, and we were saying like, well, the Chinese dog should win because he did the thing really, and the Chinese dog does win.
He does, yeah.
So
it's not so bad that, it's nice that Marmaduke lost fairly.
Yeah. So, I was kind of like, oh, that's kind of cool, kind of fun, unexpected. So Marmaduke, he does not win the show. He does not get the $1 million. But
he does get into a fight with Zeus and we didn't even mention that there's this mysterious martial arts technique that he was trying to figure out, which involves basically punching someone from across the room.
Oh, yeah, but he does figure it out.
Yeah. Also, he can hold up one of his paws and it turns into a smiley face like Mr. Bimbo.
Yeah, he does that a couple times. It's
kind of weird.
Yeah.
It feels like something they invented during the animation.
Yeah. I'm sure they were like, "Oh, hey, what if we did this?" Okay.
And anyway, what with one thing and another, Marmaduke gets crushed to death. Sorry, kids.
Can't believe Marmaduke is fucking dead.
What happens is during the fight with Zeus, he knocks down one of the big platforms that holds up the cameraman, and it falls on Marmaduke as he jumps to get Owner Boy out of the way. And then it turns out he's okay after all. So, yay.
It reminds me of like back in the old days of the, mid-morning of the internet with Joe Mathlete Explains Marmaduke, when it was always, yeah, Marmaduke is dead.
the best interpretation of Marmaduke.
Yeah. But then everything turns out okay, I think.
Yeah, and then we have this big 2D animated sequence.
Yeah.
And then it sort of goes into the ending of Cats Don't Dance.
Everybody, yeah, isn't there, there's like a big dance number, I think, right?
Yeah, there's a big dance number, and we get to see what happens to everybody. Among other things, we see that Zeus has gone to the pound, he gets shaved, and then we see him, you know, doing a will work for food on the sidewalk. I was like, man, they just can't get enough of giving this, giving this dog the, oh God, he's even got a bottle in his hand.
Yeah, they really, they really went hard on Zeus.
Yeah, this villain has gotten his comeuppance more than anyone since R.J. Fletcher from UHF. You know, we just needed an old lady to come by and be like, aren't you Zeus, that beautiful dog? And knee him in the balls really hard.
Yeah, this is, we also get to see the Fabio twins in jail and later busking on the street. So yeah, they were really, they, in these 2D sequences, they were like, look, we really want to emphasize that like crime does not pay.
Yeah.
And
also I like that Guy Hilton also wins champion for entering King Tut in a cat contest.
Oh yeah, that's right. So you know, I guess he is the world's greatest dog trainer. He can even train cats. Yep. Which is probably even harder, honestly, you know. Because how are you going to train a cat? You can't.
They are not receptive to punishment. You can only use positive reinforcement.
Yeah. But I mean, think about it. Why would you want to punish a cat?
Yeah, exactly. Why would you want to train a cat except to use the toilet instead of the litter box?
Yeah. Because like, if you ask me, cats are perfect just the way they are. So there's no way you can improve.
Especially ours.
That's right. But anyway, so that is Marmaduke 2022. But
yeah, and over the credits we get all these scenes of Marmaduke reenacting other sequences from other shows or movies.
Oh, is he doing stuff from other movies?
Yeah, let's see. We have him as Luke Skywalker, him as 2001, him as the Lion King.
Oh yeah, okay. Because I guess like the
Jaws. Him as Spider-Man, him as E.T., him as Superman. I guess they kind of ran out of movies everyone would know.
I'm still my favorite part is just Marmaduke showing up in the sunglasses and the little hoodie and the, you know, the little bone medallion. Because he's going to do a rap. Marmaduke is going to rap.
I don't know. I'm just... Yeah. Now I just want him to do the improvised rap from Sorry to Bother You, where at the end he just starts yelling, dog shit, dog shit, dog, dog, dog shit.
Marmaduke. Well, he's a big dog. I will say, I gotta say, like, of all the Marmaduke media that we've watched, I do feel like this one is the one that most, effectively conveys the essence of Marmaduke, which is he's a big dog.
Yep.
Because
God damn, that's a big fucking dog.
Because like, what else have we seen? It's literally like there's the 2010 movie. We saw Marmaduke in Heathcliff, and you know, this is definitely
for now. This is the end of the Marmaduke media.
Yeah, this is the most Marmaduke of all the Marmaduke media. I mean, it's like I don't know. I guess.
Yeah, I mean, can I really take offense at them not being accurate to the comic when I never actually liked the comic that much anyway?
Yeah, I mean, the comic, there's nothing to be accurate to, you know. It's
he's still a big dog.
Yeah,
you know, they didn't get that part wrong.
No. Wait for the Howard Hughes movie, and then
yeah. You know. Oh man, I can't wait for the Howard Hughes movie. Don't tell me to wait.
Oh, it's gonna be great. Bunny Host, Benny Horstadter, yeah, whatever her name is.
So no, you had it right the first time.
Oh, was it? Okay. Whenever she sells the rights to do the Howard Hughes movie, which that's because that's a big dog too.
Yes.
People love movies about big dogs.
Yeah. Well, it's a lot easier than owning one.
I mean, that's true. I would not want to have a big dog because, you know,
there was a, for a couple of weeks ago, there was a brief moment when it looked like we might have the opportunity to adopt a dog because my mom and I went to the park to eat our shrimp burritos and there was this really adorable, fluffy little mop dog just running around chasing some skateboarders. And they were like, is this your dog? Or it was like, no, is it yours? So we ended up, you know, taking the dog home to my brother who has three dogs and knows all about how to get dogs back to their owners. And the owners got in touch with him within an hour, which is, you know, kind of too bad because I kind of wanted to keep the dog. It was a really great dog.
Oh.
But it was one of those dogs where you're like, you know, we know that you must have gotten away accidentally because no one would just get rid of a dog like this.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but I know how that is. Cause like when you see one, you're like, oh, I want this now. I want this dog.
Yeah.
That was like when we went went down to the shelter and we're like, oh, we just want to look at a kitten, you know, just to see what they're like. And we're like, we want this cat now. We need to have this one.
It's like, you know, how do you leave without the cat who said, I'm your cat now?
Yeah.
Like, oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He's a good cat. So
I know it delights me how much you dote on him.
He's a little gentleman. He's like, whenever I see him, I'm always like, oh, Sandy. Oh, Sandy, do you want a little kiss on your nose? Do you want a little kiss? Oh, yes, you do. Yes, you do. He likes little kisses. See, his sister is a little more, she's more of a normal cat. So she's like, no, I'm going to put my, going to like turn away. But Sandy is like, no, he'll tolerate it. So there are two things though about Marmaduke that I just realized from the Wikipedia article here, assuming these are both accurate. One is that the Wikipedia article refers to Zeus in different parts as an Afghan or a Borzo. So it's like, come on, get your act together, Wikipedia.
I mean, he does have kind of a long snout, but not a Borzo snout. It's too broad. You're right. He has a kind of Saurian countenance.
Yeah. And the other thing is that the dog, the woman on TV who like challenged, Guy Hamilton to train this dog.
The real Mary Hart.
Yeah, I didn't realize that. Mary Hart from Entertainment Tonight plays Entertain Mutt tonight in this movie.
So there's a whole show just about the news in dog entertainment.
Yeah, I do think that's interesting that like, they were like, look, we're going to get Mary Hart. You remember Mary Hart, the famous host of Entertainment Tonight, because I was having a conversation with my wife recently about the whole concept of Entertainment Tonight, because she had never watched it. And I'd seen it when I was a kid and I was trying to explain to her like, OK, what you have to understand is like there were two people on it. John Tesh, who has since completely rebranded himself as a new age musician to the point that nobody remembers he was co-host of Entertainment Tonight.
You're right. I didn't.
Like everyone forgot, you know? I mean, that was the thing is at first everyone made fun of him because it was all like, oh, the Entertainment Tonight guy is going to be a new age musician, whatever. And now apparently he was really good at it because that's all we know him for now. And Mary Hart, whom longtime fans probably mostly know from my rants about the worst weight gain fetish fiction ever written, The Fat Zone, where Jennifer Lopez, Anna Nicole Smith, various 90s female celebrities known for
Liv Tyler in there too.
I which one? Sorry, Liv Tyler?
I think.
I think so. That sounds right. A bunch of like,
I just remembering your rants.
Yeah, like a bunch of women celebrities at the time and Mary Hart go to the fat dimension, which is a magical dimension where they just scream the word fat over and over while the author tells us, like, now they weigh 5 million pounds each. Now they're 8 million pounds each. Now they're 20,000 million pounds each. And it's like, I can't get off on this. I'm going to, like, hunt down the 13-year-old who wrote that and, like, give them a stern talking to about, like, quality control. Anyway.
Turns out that kid also grew up to be a great New Age musician.
I've actually just realized I'm kind of sad that, like, finally the, Dimensions Online completely scrubbed its library, and now not even the Wayback Machine can find it anymore. So the fat dimension, it can no longer be found. That is passed into the ether. It's just a legend.
Yeah, remember when we used to say the internet is forever?
Yeah, not when you want it to be, though. This is like,
that was before in shitification.
Yeah, I mean, this is like, I had a friend, and he was always telling me about this fetish story that he had found, run across once and could never find again, where I think it's poison ivy like feeds Harlequin till she's like, you know, hugely fat, and then cooks her and eats her and then shits her out in a giant shit log that is shaped like Harlequin. And it was, he's always telling me about this, and I was like, I don't believe that exists. That sounds made up. I think you made that up. But then, lo and behold, we found it. We actually found it. Or I found it. And I sent it to
and
him.
And he didn't show it
like,
to you?
And he was like, the legends are real. I told you. Anyway, that's the internet for you. We're being very family friendly at the end of this episode, just like Marmaduke.
Yes. Okay. No, let's change it so Poison Ivy shits Harley Quinn out in a giant Harley Quinn-shaped shit log into the dog show trophy.
And there's just a whole lot of green smoke as well.
It was yellow pollen smoke.
It was funny because when I mentioned we're talking about this, and my wife was like, you know, it's not green. Farts are not green. They don't have any color at all, technically. But like, you probably think they'd be more of a brown in cartoons. And I was like, yeah, but if you put brown farts in a cartoon, like, people would write letters. You have to kind of have that like poison arrow frog green so that people don't get mad, you know?
I mean, we all saw the Ren and Stimpy episode with Stinky the Fart.
Mm.
He was kind of green tinged, but he was mostly brown. And, you know, my dad said, God, he looks like a flying turd.
Wow. Do you think that was on purpose?
Well, I'm sure. I mean, you know, what color is the smell of a fart? Wow. Yeah. That's a koan right there. Hey, now I should win the dog show.
Just remember, you have to be the fart.
Be the fart before, and you will not want to eat the fart like you normally do.
Yeah, all that's right. True. Well, that is a problem for dogs. You know, they do love eating farts. Anyway, anything else we should say about Marmaduke 2022?
Well, let's see. Oh, this was actually supposed to air. This is actually supposed to premiere 3 years earlier. It was supposed to. It was announced to come out in 2019.
Huh.
And then the pandemic happened, and then it was, and, oh no, yeah, it was first announced for release in the second quarter of 2019, then slated for release in 2020, but was delayed due to COVID-19, acquired by Netflix, and finally released on April 8th, 2022. Hey, that's Steph's birthday. Happy birthday, Steph.
Oh, happy birthday, Steph. We got a great birthday present for you. I think that you got, you're gonna love it.
Hey, wait a minute. I think this is actually gonna air on April 8th.
Oh, well, Steph, happy birthday. Yes. Please enjoy this discussion of Marmaduke and the best of Marmaduke related media. I think treat yourself on your special day to, you know, just a massive fart in a dog trophy. Because, you know what? you deserve it.
You're
you,
worth
you
it.
You deserve to see this quality animation. Anyway, Marmaduke.
Wow. And happy first birthday to Marmaduke 2022. Second birthday.
I was going to say, like, Marmaduke, more like Marmadon't, but honestly, no, go watch Marmaduke. Watch Marmaduke 2022. Or 2020, whatever.
It was.
It's the best Marmaduke adaptation that you will see. Probably ever.
Because it leaves out all of the parts that you didn't care about, which is all of them.
Yeah. I mean, if they just gave Phil a mustache, it would be 10 out of 10, but...
Yes. I mean, Marmaduke tried, but he missed and hit the bowl.